Good evening. We're continuing our series, The Psychology of the Mind and the Soul. This is session number 5. We have one more before I go to Israel, which will be next Monday. Hopefully we'll do as much as we can, and then we will have 4 weeks off. We'll be back after I come back, end of January. Remember this. You can go on my event to check when is the next lecture here. I don't know if you're aware, but this series, the comments that I get about it from all over the world is beyond any words can describe. It's really changing already the life of many people. So you have a very big zchut here. We're running out of time, as you know. The Arabs are increasing the terrorism more and more everywhere. Things is about to explode. Baruch Hashem, the Jews are picking sides. Some go to the positive, some drowning in the negative side. Some will be saved, some will be destroyed, unfortunately, as we spoke over the years. We want to be the ones that go all the way to the extreme positive side, not to stick in the middle, and definitely not to be in the negative side. I just came from Shabbaton with 1,000 Hasidim, Bli Ayin Hara, in Crown Plaza in Connecticut, very big hotel there. Yeah, it's called Keraftano, the organization. It's Hasidei Bels and other Hasidim, Satmer and others. It's mamash, it's like you feel you're in heaven for 3 days. With Torah and so many lectures and so many people. Amazing, really amazing. And the Shabbos meal and the music, it's mamash like a mini Ma'amad Har Sinai. Like you feel you participate almost in Har Sinai. This is the moments that brings hearts together, make unity between all different kinds of Jews, different kinds of Hasidim, Hasidim and not Hasidim, Baruch Hashem. May we always have good, positive things like that. We all get closer to Hashem. Okay, so last week, if you remember, we spoke about people that are busy imitating others, which in a higher level and with much greater potential. And as a result of that, these people are being upset when they cannot achieve the same level of those who they are imitating, and they break. You understand? So if you see someone is in a madregat chassid, which is higher than righteous, and he does certain things, and you, whether you're a beginner or you're someone that cannot reach such potential, and you try to do the same thing, just because you're jealous, which is good. It's good to be jealous with righteous people that do the right thing. Maybe I'll be like them. It's called kinat sofrim tarbe chokhmah. But if you try to imitate what some people do and you're not in their level, it can break you mentally. And that's the warning that we finished the last lecture with. Now we're continuing. Rabbeinu Yonah, which lived about 800-900 years ago, he has a question about the words of King David. King David writes, Chatot ne'urai upsha'ai al tizkor. Chatot ne'urai, the sins of my youth, and the crime do not remember. Meaning, erase it. Erase it from my file. The question is, what does it mean, Chatot ne'urai? Chatot comes from the word chet. Chet in Hebrew means sin, but what kind of sin? Not intentional sin. Psha'ai, pesha, it's an intentional sin to get Hashem angry. You have a glat kosher beef and you eat the non-kosher beef. Same steak. You have here and you have across the street another restaurant which is not kosher. Why? On purpose. Rebelling. That's called psha'ai. So David HaMelech say, the sins of my youth, the sin of my youth, don't remember. And when he speaks about his intentional sins, he doesn't say the word youth. Meaning when I got older. When I got older, they became intentional. When I was a kid, when I was 16, 17, 14, even though I did it on purpose, sins of desire maybe or things like that, since I was young and not mature, is already naming them not intentional sins. What does it mean? We have a rule, we bring korban chatat, sacrifice of a non-intentional sins that we do, for only a sin that we did not unintentionally. Like by mistake we broke Shabbat, we forgot it's Shabbat, we didn't look at the time, we thought it's over or it didn't start yet, and then we realized we broke Shabbat accidentally. So we have to bring a sacrifice to Beit HaMikdash. It's called Korban Chatat, sacrifice of Chatat, for an unintentional sin. We have to understand why David HaMelech doesn't speak about the intentional sins that he made in his youth days. What about, why he's only asking Hashem to forgive the unintentional? The answer, because everything is included in the word Chatot Neurai. The unintentional sins of my youth. Even when they were intentional, since I was not mature in my mind, I'm still like a kid, although I was bar mitzvah, but between bar mitzvah to 20 years old, not everyone get mature in the same speed. Many of them I did because of lack of maturity. And therefore, they go to a level of unintentional sins, which is a very big chidush. Rabbeinu Yonah says that all of that is included in a word, chatot neurai. Gam azdonot nechshavot shgagot. Even the intentional ones are considered also unintentional. Unless they were made after he got mature. Usually up to 20, everyone gets mature. Not in these days. Today I already found people, even 25, they act like kids. Very immature. But back 3,000 years ago, by 20, everyone was mature, even the slow people. They were mature by then. But for some people, you get mature age 16, some people 18, some people 14, depend on a person. But we have to understand that Hashem knows the moment of maturity by a person. Once you're really mature in everything in life, then you have the ability to understand the consequences of your crimes. Because if a person is a fool, is dismissed from keeping mitzvot. Why? He doesn't understand the consequences of his crimes. Therefore, how are you going to punish someone like that? That his brain is limited. It's very difficult. But someone that understands about business, money, everything he understands very well, when it comes to mitzvot, he says, I'm dumb. It's, what do you want to punish me? I'm dumb. Oh, you're dumb? In money, you're not dumb. In other things, you're very clever. If you're dumb in everything, then you actually have a discount. Who say it's not good to be dumb? You can get a good discount. The answer, it's better to be wise, not dumb. Wise, you have better life. And when you're wise, you don't touch what you're not supposed to touch. That's the bottom line. Ma'u zman ha-ne'orim, the Radak, Rabbi David Cordovero, hundreds of years ago, he said, like I said, maximum up to age 20. Rabbeinu Yonah doesn't say a specific date. He says it's specific to every human being. Like I said, some people like this, some people like that. Chazal saying, our sages, there are three powers that preventing a person from committing sins. Three different kinds of powers that can hold a person from committing a sin. One, intelligence. Your intelligence, your wisdom. You understand how ugly is this thing you're about to do. You learn about it. You understand the consequences of that. And you can tell the difference between good and bad if you're wise. Who is the easiest people to make them balei tshuva? The easiest. People that have good heart and people that have sharp brain. The rest is much harder. People that don't have such good heart, it's very hard. People that are not so smart, it's very hard. Depend what tactics you use.
If you use scientific proof, you need a person to be sharp and get the point. Now you understand that only God could have written the Torah. No human being was able to write such a book. It's a big impact on him. He never knew it until now. But at the same time, you need him to have a good heart, because many smart people, they see the truth, and right away they convince themselves that they didn't see it. Because either they're evil, or they're ungrateful, or they're full of desires, and they're not willing to change. That's a sign of evilness sometimes. So, wisdom. Second, fear from the punishment. There's a price. I don't want to pay it. I don't want to lose, chas v'shalom, my legs in an accident. I don't want to become blind. I don't want to lose all my money. I don't want to get cancer. I don't want to lose a child. I don't want to stay single. There's so many tragedies in the world. You got to be a fool not to see how many people suffering and so much suffering in the world. Hard to believe. If I only recorded to you 1% of the conversations I get every week with problems of people, you will not believe how much people suffering. You won't believe. You won't believe. All people that losing their homes in their 70s, they have nowhere to go to live. Think about it. In their age, they have to go to one of their kids and sleep in a living room. Just think about it. You want to faint. People who just found out they have cancer, 20, 21 years old, found out they have cancer, they have to start fighting for their life. All kinds of problems like this. Lots of tragedies. Lots of tragedies. So fear from the punishment. Police, Gehenom, Olam Haba. And the third, what's the third thing that can prevent a person from committing sins? Shame. Shame. What? He's ashamed from his friends. You live in a religious community. What are you going to do? You're going to dress like a clown when it's not Purim. Your friends are going to know right away, you're off the derech. You're going down, ma. You used to wear black and white, like yeshiva bachur, now you want to come with a pink shirt. Someone that becoming Baal Tshuva, no one expects him to dress black and white in the first year. He's not in a level. But someone that is already dressed like that 7 years, 8 years, 10 years, and now he has the desire to dress differently, going out of the frame. Not that it matters so much the clothes. As long as the clothes are modest, really, it's not the most important thing in the world. The significance of the clothes is, do I belong to this group or I don't want to be affiliated with them? This is really what it symbolizes. If you're a Hasid, the Hasidim all dress the same. Same hats, in Shabbat it's fair hats, and special black clothes, and the white shirts, and the tzitzit outside or inside, or whatever the custom is. Sometimes the socks is all the way up. It's different kinds of Hasidish, but more or less it's very similar. So if somebody now will change different, will dress differently, although he will keep all the mitzvot, everything, Shabbat, Kashrut, learning every day, everything by him stay the same, it's good midot. Technically, it's still a tzaddik, but by him showing up to the community one day with different kinds of clothes, even a short jacket, even when he put a tie and a short jacket, which no one of the Hasidim dressed like that in his neighborhood, everybody there would look at that as this person opened a war against us. It's rebelling against the muskamot, against the what accepted here. And again, it's not because it's a crime to wear a short jacket or to put a tie. Big rabbis dress like that. Because over here, no one does it. And if you are here and you're doing it, you are actually telling us, I'm ashamed to be like you. I want to be different than all of you. I don't accept the way you are. Even though it's only clothes. You understand? For someone from the outside, it looks like a joke. Ah, for that they say that you started a war because you dressed a different shirt or a different jacket. Wow, who cares about this thing, right? For someone else. For some Baal Tshuva somewhere. You won't understand that. But you know that there are significance in these things. And by the way, it's not only by the religious world like that, it's also in the secular world. If you work for a company and have uniforms, and you decide to come one day with your clothes without the uniform, immediately your boss would look at that as you are fighting against the constitution and the laws of the company. Same thing in the army. Same thing in the army. You have uniforms, you want to come with your jeans with your holes. This you wear when you go to the bar, not when you go to fight. You go to fight, you come with uniform. You understand? So in hotel, they have all these waiters that dress in a specific way with uniform. If one of them would show up with pink clothes today, immediately they'll send him home. Why? I can help, I can work. I will work just as good. No, you cannot represent us. Why? Because everyone would look at you like you rebel against us. You don't want to be like us. We don't want you in our team. That's the way the world is. No one make a big deal out of it. Sometimes when it comes to religion, since there's Yetzirah, people like to make a big deal out of it. But this is the way the world is. So those three things prevent a person from committing sins. One, intelligence, wisdom. He can tell the difference between good and bad, and how ugly is the action that he's about to do. Second, fear from the punishment. And third, shame. He's ashamed from his friend, from his family. He's ashamed from himself. And most of all of that is ashamed from Hashem. All the above, all kinds of shame. A person is embarrassed to do things, and because of the shame, he gets saved. According to Rabbeinu Yonah, as I started to explain, the sins of my youth is different based on the individual, his mental condition and his age. And the age of every person is not equal to the other. Two 17 years old boys or girls, man one will be punished like it's intentional, and the other one will be punished like it's not intentional. Yes? When a person has what?
Gevura.
Do you know what Gevura means?
I thought it was like strength.
Gevura, it's a brave person.
I thought it also could be used in the context of being able to control yourself and not commit sins.
Disciplines.
Discipline.
Well, the question is disciplines preventing a person from committing sins. But the discipline, where does it come from? One, from intelligence. Second, from fear from the consequences, fear from the punishment, and third, the shame. That's what discipline is. So you're actually right, if that's what you try to say. That actually discipline is a combination of all three, right, if that's what you say. So as I started to explain, in a young age, the brain is still weak. The ability of the brain, the intelligence is not perfect yet. And the desires are very strong, even stronger than later. Who has stronger desire, 17, 18 years old boy or 65, 70? 17, 18. It's very, the fire, everything is fire. And the brain is weak. There's no life experience, that's another problem. The Yetzer Hara is in the strongest level it's ever going to be. And the ability to tell the difference between good and bad is blurry. Very difficult for a person to know what's good for him, what's bad. And I want to help that his father will give him speeches. His answer will be, you see why I hate to talk to you? You're always judging me. That's the American thing. I don't like to talk to him. Why you don't talk to your dad? He's always judging me. Why he's judging you? Because he told you don't do this and don't do that. What's wrong with what he said? He's trying to help you out. The mentality of a person is weak. He doesn't see it right now. Things that he doesn't see then, he will see 10 years later, and it will burn his heart. Why didn't I listen back then? The answer, you just couldn't. Your brain was not developed fully, as Rabbeinu Yonah explains here. So, Rav Shmuel HaKohen Shlita, this is what he said. He said that when we used to sit in a shiur of Rav Shlomo Hoffman, which is this big psychologist that we base this series on, his learning and experience, every time he used to remind us what he heard from Rav Isaac Sher Zatzal, one of Gdolei Ador was Rav Isaac Sher in Ashkenaz. And he said, the Gemara in Masechet Nedarim, page 9, the Gemara says like this, Amar Shimon HaTzadik, Shimon HaTzadik said, Miyamai lo achalti asham nazir, Tameh Ela Echad. One time I had to bring a korban of Hasham, Nazir, Tameh, one time, that's it. Pam achat, this now is telling why. One time came, why? You need people to bring that korban. People that accept on themselves to be Nazir. The word monk, it's not the right word, but that's the closest. Someone that is Nazir, that means he's not going to touch grapes, no raisins, no wine, none of these things. So one person came from the south, and I saw that he's handsome. Handsome young man. And his hair is nice curls. I told him, son, why did you come to lose such beautiful hair? He told me, I was a shepherd working for my father in my town. I went to get water from the lake. I looked at myself on the water, the reflection, and my Yetzer Hara went rising like fire. I looked at myself, like today in a mirror. What a handsome guy I am. Why I'm not taking advantage of my beauty? Is Yetzer Hara started? What? Let me go to the market. Look, maybe I'll find myself a pretty girl. That's what went through his mind. Amarti lo, I said to my evil inclination, Rasha, wicked, why are you proud of something that is not yours and is going to become worms? Soon it's going to be worms. What do you think? Your beauty is going to remain? Why are you proud of something that, first, it's not yours? Hashem gave it, and he did not give it to you to go make sins, that's for sure. And the second, is anyway going to be eaten by the worms. It'll become all worms, all the skin and eyes and everything. What do you think is going to happen with that? I swear that I'm going to shave you, meaning the hair, the beautiful hair. I'm going to shave it and give it to Shamayim, like a sacrifice. Miyad amadeti v'nishaktiv al rosho. Right away I got up and I kissed him on his head. Amarti lo, bni, I told him, my son, irbu kmotcha nozre nezirut b'Yisrael. May the nation of Israel will be many like you that make all these vows to become nezirim, to go away from wine and from pleasure, even though it's not recommended. Why it's not recommended? If it was recommended, why do you have to bring a sacrifice to ask Hashem for mechila, for forgiveness that you became a nazir? If it's positive, you should not apologize for it. The reason you apologize for it, because Hashem doesn't like it so much. But over here, it's an exception to the rule. It was mandatory, it was necessary. Alav ha-katuv omer ish ki afli v'chule. Tov. Rav Isaac asked a few questions. Question number one, im pachaz alav yitzro biglal gidul sa'arotav, madu alo gaza sa'arotav miyad? Lama hu tzrach lingzor nezirut al atzmo? Question number one, if you thought that you're too handsome with this beautiful hair, why didn't you just have a haircut? Why do you need to make such a ceremony to become a nazir? Go have a haircut, finished. I have to come to the Kohen and announce that you're going to be a Nazir and shave your head and I'm not going to touch you. What's for? That's question number one. Question number two, what did he mean, Rav Shimon HaTzadik, when he asked him, why did you see reasons to destroy such beautiful hair that you have? Since when rabbis talks like that? Rabbi care about his hair, that is nice. Doesn't make sense. It's mandatory. If any, the rabbi should have told him, what took you so long until you come to shave this hair? What, you're a woman? That's what he should have told him. Man is a man. Woman is a woman. Needs hair. Man doesn't need long hair. And the third, why he was so impressed by his answer that he got up and kissed him and said, may you have many, when we have many like you in the nation of Israel. Three good questions or no? The answer, he said, ממעשה זה יש ללמוד דרך במלחמה בהתמודדות עם היצר. From here we learn how you battle against your evil inclination, against your יצר הרע. When the יצר come and attack a person, when your evil inclination come to attack you, אלו להשיב במהלך נחפז לעמוד נגדו. Don't rush to take actions against him and answer him right away. If you whisper inside your head, go and do this, why you're not doing that, don't right away panic, think, this is what you should do. If you react immediately, you're going to lose. When this Nazir, when this monk, he saw that his Yetzer Hara taking over his heart, if he would shave his hair immediately he ran to shave his head, he would not get rid of the Yetzer Hara. He will only treat the symptom, not the root of the problem. So as soon as the hair will grow in a month or two, same thing would happen again. The problem will never be removed from the system. Still have the virus. Right now, you limit the power of the virus. Well, you cut the hair, that's it. But it's gonna grow back and will still make its damage. That's something that comes not from knowing yourself from inside and fixing the root of your problem. That's why he said, let me first be a Nazir. And only that I will shave the hair. Why? Because now being a Nazir, I'm going to work on myself day by day, week by week, until I will defeat my Yetzer Hara, and then, obviously, it will never ever come back to me. What Shimon HaTzadik asked him, why did you come to destroy such nice hair? Because he thought, he rushed to do it without thinking the consequences. So what's the point? It's only a temporary relief. He wanted to see if he really understands how to treat it. לאחר ששמע ממנו את מקור ההחלטה, הבין שמדובר בתהליך מחושב. After he investigated him, he realized this guy is not just pulling a trick. No, he was thinking deeply about it. He didn't rush. Then he knew that he won't regret becoming a Nazir. If you regret, what's the point? Bottom line, everything that we do have to be calculated. You jump and you rush to something, not thinking about all the details, the problem will not go away. It will temporarily be relieved, but then it will come right back. The Rambam is making a separation between two terms, two expressions, guilt and guilty feelings. Can you tell me what's the difference between them? If you come to a person and you say to him, I have guilty feelings, he gets the point. If you tell him, I feel guilt, I have guilt, it's the same thing, no? Do you see any difference between the two? If you say, I have guilt, or if you say, I feel guilty feelings, there's any difference between the two? Or it's really a different way to pronounce it. Do you find a difference between the two or no? In Hebrew, it sounds like this, Ashma and Rikshot Ashma. Ashma means guilt. Rikshot Ashma means regesh feelings. Rikshot, feelings, plural. Guilty feelings. The Rambam distinguished between them. In modern psychology, they speak about something similar, that people have two different kinds of guilt. Let's first explain. When a person is feeling, when he has guilt, ashma, is when a person has a strong desire to do something bad, negative, and he could not hold himself and fail against his Yetzer Hara, against his evil inclination. After he did something bad, he begins to feel bad with himself, and he regrets what he did. And he begins to ask, why did I do it? Why do I have to do it? Why did I do it again? Why? That's how he feels. Why did I hurt that person? Why did I answer him back? Why did I have to speak? Why did I commit that sin? Why I did not overcome my yetzer hara? Why I was not careful? All these thoughts coming to the person's mind. This is guilt or guilty feelings? That's guilt. What's guilty feelings? A person is convinced that he did something bad, although he never did it. He never did it. So automatically, even though he did whatever he did, but the consequences of what he's thinking that he committed a sin, it wasn't a sin. It wasn't a sin. So, because in his mind he's convinced that he committed a sin, he has the same feelings that I mentioned before. Why did I do it? Why I don't? I cannot control my yetzer hara. I wish I wouldn't do it. All these feelings are the same. But ashma means you did it. Rikshot ashma means illusion. You're hallucinating that you actually did it. You convince yourself you did it. If we connect you to a lie detector, you will admit to something you never did. You never did. Many of the mothers living with constant guilty feelings that they are responsible for everything bad happened to their children. I'm not a good mother, it's because of me, it's because of me, it's because of me, it's all my fault. And they take it to the heart until they collapse. When in reality, they've done nothing wrong most of the time. I give you an example. A mother goes with a little child to the supermarket and he screams for chocolate or candy. She screams. She didn't buy him. Now she gets in a car and is screaming, choking. She feels guilty feeling. What a bad mother I am. How can I be so cruel? Why didn't I just buy him the candy? Why am I so tough? Why? She eats her heart. Did she commit a sin? The opposite. She did something very positive. She'll get a great V by Hashem. Why? Of course, shouldn't surrender to the babies everything they see you give them. You destroy them like that. You destroy their judgment in the world. They expect the whole world to work for them. Everybody is my servant here. Whatever I want, I make a scream and they all run to serve me. So who says it's good? It's not good, but she has guilty feelings. She has guilty feelings. Many examples that people just have. They feel guilty about things that they really do not do. I'll give you an example. One time I got a call from a person from Los Angeles, Persian guy. I never saw his face. I don't know his name. He called me up with guilty feelings. He said to me, I feel horrible. What? I listened to your lecture about peace in the family, Shalom Bayit now. And a lot of the things that you said that husbands do to their wife, I actually do to my wife. I just realized it. And I really feel horrible about it. So I said to him, let's hear. Give me some details. What are you talking about? So he said that he may not always respect her enough and sometimes maybe he doesn't speak, you know, properly. And I asked him, what did she do that you get to do such thing? What did she do? What did she get you angry? What is she doing? So he said to me, you know, since I got married, I only have been with her one time, intimately. The night of the wedding or the week of the wedding, and that's it. And we've been married for more than 20 years. I said to him, how can it be? One time only and you survive all these years? He said, yes. And then he started to go on and he said that I have three children. I said, three children with being one time? This guy should win the lottery. You know? People tried 50 times until the one time it works. This guy, one shot, triplet. That's what I said, what? One time was with his wife, triplet? I'm thinking, how can it be? What are the odds? So right away, since it doesn't make sense, I asked him, if you've been with her only once, how come you have three kids? He told me lab, transplant, in a lab, artificially, meaning she's allergic to him, she doesn't let him come near her. So I say to him, I don't understand. This marriage has no value. It should have been divorced a long time ago. That's not marriage. Marriage needs connection. It's a part of the marriage between husband and wife. So I said, I was thinking out loud, who knows how many sins she made you do all these years? Then he became serious. And he said, oh, no, no, God forbid. No sins. I'm very careful. I never make any sins. I said to him, all these years you never made sins? You have a woman in the house next to you, she doesn't let you touch her, and you never made sins around her? And he said that he loves her and this, you know, this whole thing. He said, no, I'm very careful. I'm afraid of Hashem. I will never do it. I said to him, you're greater than Yaakov Avinu. You're calling me for advice, for bracha. You are Yaakov Avinu of the generation. Yaakov Avinu say, Reuven, my son, is Reshit Oni. First seed came out of my body in my 80s. How can you not be impressed? Person, first time seeds come out of his body, never made a sin in his life, 80 years. Amazing. It's a very high level of holiness. But in our generation, in such a world, I tell you the truth, I don't want to talk too much. I'm wondering to myself loudly, if Yaakov Avinu would live with Rachel in the same room for 20 years and she wouldn't let him touch her, if he would be able to survive. I'm wondering to myself if he'll be able to say Reshit Oni. It's one thing, you don't have a woman, you don't have a wife, and you're looking for Shiduch all these years and you suffer. It's a much, much harder when you have a wife and you desire her and she's next to you in your bedroom and you cannot touch her for whatever reasons. Here you go. There are people like this in our generation. And he has guilty feelings. He feels horrible. He's supposed to divorce her a long time ago. And he walks with a bitter, broken heart. Maybe he's not nice enough to her. That's called guilty feelings. There's a difference between feelings and guilty, ashma, guilt, and guilty feelings. Remember this. In Hebrew it sounds much better. Ashma, rikshot ashma. There is a famous halacha in Gemara, en adam mesim et atzmo rasha. Person does not make himself a status of a wicked person in a public. For instance, if a person comes to Bet Din, meaning Sanhedrin, that they can execute a person. 71 judges, rabbis, Sanhedrin, and he say, Chilalti Shabbat. I violated Shabbat. I'm guilty. He comes to confess. I murdered. Remember this guy that they found, his body was found? I killed him. I ate not kosher. They're not allowed to believe him. How can it be? If today someone comes to the police station, you're looking for the murder of this guy, I'm the one. Police allowed to believe him or no? Yeah. Don't be so sure. There are regulations here. Soon I'll explain to you the regulations. Of course, they cannot ignore him, but to already jump to conclusion that it's him, not so fast. You have to check. Why? Maybe he's taking the guilt for his brother. Maybe he's taking the guilt for his son. He's 60 and his son is 25. He's thinking, I lived most of my life. What's my son is going to lose now? His life, his business, family. What do I have? Better I'll be in jail, play chess with the, you know, jail mates. Listen to the radio. Watch a little basketball. I have nothing to lose. I'll take the guilt. How do you know? Maybe he's depressed. He wanna die. Just kill me. I don't wanna live anyway. I don't have the guts to kill myself. You kill me. I don't wanna commit suicide. It's murder. You kill me. Why should I kill myself? They have to send him home. Say, Enough, enough with your nonsense. Go. How do we learn it? Well, who gave us permission to teach such thing? Come on, it's a controversial law. Where does it come from that you don't believe him? The answer, it says in the Torah, Asher Yarshiun Elokim, that he will be found guilty by the Bet Din. Elokim Nitzav Be'adat El, that's Bet Din. Bet Din have to find him guilty based on the testimony of two witnesses and up. 2, 3, 10, 20, the more the better, but 2 minimum. Not that he was convicted based on his own admission. 2 witnesses only. Prat la marshia et atzmo. Someone who convict himself? No. The Rambam in the laws of Sanhedrin explain where this supposedly strange halacha comes from. Sounds strange, you have to admit. Person admit that he is b'chalel shoran, you don't believe him? The Rambam says in Hilchot Sanhedrin, chapter 18, halacha 6, Gzerat HaKatuvi, it's a decree of Hashem in his Torah. Gzerah, that's it. Accept it. En memitim bedin velo malkim et ha'adam bodat piv el al pi shnei edim. You don't execute a person, you don't hit him with a whip based on his own testimony and admission. You must have 2 witnesses. Now the Rambam asks a question. Yehoshua ben Nun, he killed Achan. Who was Achan? He is the one who took from all the jewelry and all the things, you know, that Hashem said, yeah, in Jericho, in Jericho, when you come and occupy Jericho and, you know, you win the war, you're occupying Eretz Israel, nobody is allowed to touch from all the wealth. You know, no one is allowed to take. There's diamonds, there's cash, there's silver coin, animals, whatever. You don't take it. But then somebody did take. Hashem got very angry. In the end, they were about to do lottery to find out who really did it. And Achan admitted, confessed, and Yehoshua killed him. Why? The Rambam said, based on what I say now, you should have not believed him. Maybe he's taking the guilt for his cousin, for his father, no? The answer, because this was Tzav HaShaa, exception to the rule. Meaning, they knew from Hashem that that's the right thing to do. Because Hashem came and said to him, one of the people here did it. And then this Achan confessed in the end. It's also Din Malchut. The king is above Sanhedrin. The laws of Sanhedrin, the king can go override them. It's just like you have Congress and the president can put a veto against what they vote for. Same thing over there. The Torah gave power to the king that is above the court. Meaning, if somebody was found stealing, he's a thief, he got caught. What's the punishment has to be? He has to pay double. You stole 1,000, you must pay 2,000 and you go home. Pay him 2,000 and goodbye. But the king, if he got tired of so many people stealing, he can say, the next time we catch a thief, I'll kill him with my sword. And they caught a thief a week later, the king can kill him. It's not murder. The Torah didn't say that a thief has to be killed. You're not allowed to kill a king. If the Bet Din will kill a thief, it's a pure murder. They'll be punished for it. Who told you to kill thieves? But a king can take a sword and kill him on the spot. So the same thing with Achan. Maybe it was Gzerat Malchut. Or Tzav HaShaa. Tzav HaShaa means the order of a moment. A momentary, temporary order. But Sanhedrin cannot kill and cannot hit anyone who admits on a sin based on his own words. Maybe nitrefa da'ato badavar. Maybe he's mentally distressed. Temporary insanity. It's a very common thing, believe it or not. Many people found not guilty in murder by words of psychologists or psychiatrists that he had temporary insanity. They put him in a mental institution for evaluation, but he's really not, it's not crazy. He was crazy only for an hour. And after that, when does a person get temporary insanity? He lost all his money in the stock market. Years until he saved it, boom, millions in one shot. He went crazy, something happened, he did something, he lost his mind. He would never do such thing otherwise. Shema nitrefa da'ato badavar hazeh. שמה מן עמלין מראי הנפש המחכים למוות שהם תמיד תוקעים החרבות בביתנם ומשליחים עצמם מעל הגגות. Maybe he's a suicidal person. You know how many people walk with suicidal thoughts? If you don't believe, come read how many emails like this I get. Rabbi, why am I suicidal all the time? I became a psychiatrist now, psychologist. That's what's going on. The Rambam say, maybe he's waiting already to die. Or he's like those people who stick the sword in his stomach, torturing themselves until they die, hoping to die. Or throwing themselves from the roof, jumping. One time when I was in elementary school, I think I was in 8th grade or 7th grade, one of them. In Israel, on the school, back then, today I think they have a real guard. They used to put one student to be in a gate of the school. There's a gate, it's closed. If somebody comes, if you know him, let him in. If you don't know him, an Arab come, who are you, Mustafa, where from? What are you doing over here? What are you looking for? I can't speak to this teacher. So you call up the teacher and he tells you, yes, let him in, or he comes and he, okay. Usually there was really nothing to do. You sit there and watching the kids play soccer or basketball. Lucky me, when I was sitting there in a gate, like this, all of a sudden I look up, building next to my school, a guy decided to commit suicide. He jumped from the roof of the building, boom! Fell mamash close to me, his brain came out of his head. I was a kid, 13 years old, something like that. Someone decided to jump. He couldn't finish, he couldn't wait until I finished my shift. Just in my shift, he had to fall next to me. Hashem Yerachem. They asked me, do you need a psychologist? A kid is shaking up from something like this. It disturbed me for days. People commit suicide. A normal person kill himself? It's losing insanity. By the way, when a person commits suicide, he has no shirt to the world to come. You have to bury him out of the Jewish cemetery. You have to make a separation. And even Kaddish doesn't help him. And he's judged as a murderer. However, there is an exception to the rule. If it was a person in very deep depression, for weeks, for months, for years, that doesn't mean that he loses shirt to the world to come and that you can bury him outside of the Jewish cemetery, no. If a rabbi or anyone knew him and he come and testify, he wasn't responsible for his actions, it's like anus. He's not a murderer. He wasn't responsible for what he's doing. Women kill their own children in a moment of depression and insanity. Do you know a woman that just gave birth that she want to kill her baby? We're not talking a woman that accidentally became pregnant by someone without being married and she's worried about her father that will kill her. That's not what I'm talking about. Talking regular woman that wanted to have kids. And she was very proud of her pregnancy and all of a sudden she's doing horrible things to the baby. Huh?
Postpartum depression.
Yeah. It happens all the time, unfortunately. So, what does it say over here? Maybe he will confess to something he did not do that you should kill him. He's so frustrated from his life. The Rambam brings three options. One, maybe he's insane, he lost his logic, and straight thinking. Second, maybe he's bitter, waiting for the moment to die and suicidal. And third, maybe he will come and say something he did not do to get killed. It's really three different options. One, insanity. Two, be there. Be there. Three, wants to die. I never understood why between two and three there's any difference. In my opinion, it should be two. Two reasons, not three. Let's see what he says. There are three possibilities to explain why Sanhedrin do not accept his testimony against himself. The first, nitrefa da'ato ba'davar hazeh. Ze shote, shote betet, shote. A fool. What we call today psychiatric patient. Psycho. Psycho. That's the right word, right? Sounds bad, huh? Psycho. Chole nefesh. Mentally sick. This is a person, listen how he analyzes it beautifully. Sweeter than honey. This is a person that imagination and reality become mixed in his mind. Like all of us. How many people live in imagination? Next year we're going to make millions. And next year if your business will be open, it will be a miracle. The way things are going. This is a person that the imagination and the reality are mixed in his mind and looks like one thing. When they actually tell you a story that really happened, many of the details inside are only imagination. They never really took place. Even if you hypnotize him, he will repeat the same thing because for him, in his mind, it became reality. It's like those people who lie so much, they begin to believe their own lies. One guy, he said to his friend, I know you owe money to a lot of people. They bang on your door every day, they want to beat you up. I'll find you a trick, you get rid of all these people. He said, yeah, what? He said, every time they come, stand on a table like a monkey, like chimpanzee, make noises, woo-hoo, you know, jump, go crazy. They talk to you, eat your head, go like this, you know, all kinds of things like that. Jump like retarded, you know, like a monkey. Then they think, they become crazy. What can we do? He owe me money, but he's crazy. What am I going to do? You beat him up? He lost his mind. Slowly, slowly, they will all leave you. So, he started with a trick. Everyone who comes, jump like this, hanging on the chandelier. He called up his wife, Alach HaKesef. The money is gone. Why? He's insane. Top. After he finished with all of them, Baruch Hashem, he got clear. Now his friend that gave him the advice comes to him and says, okay, what about my money that you owe me? Give me. So he started, jumping on the chandelier. He said, hey, you fool, I gave you this advice, you're using it against me? He already felt that's reality for him. Forgot already that's an imagination. It happens to people. Mainly to kids. By kids, they can tell you such a convincing story. Their body language shows that according to their mind, it really happened to them. No, no, I'm telling you the truth, of course. That's happened. Come, I'll show you. And you go and you wonder, what's going on here? How is he convincing? Like in Broadway, you don't find actors like this. Not because he's a good liar. Because imagination and reality get mixed in their mind very frequently. Very. Tov. So, psychiatric case, mental. Psychiatric case, mental. Sometimes it can be as bad as a person talking to the wall. I'll beat you up, leave me alone. He's talking to the wall. You see all kinds of images. He pretend to see people. You know how many hundreds of times people came to me describing to me that they see people and they talk to them and this. Mamash imagining things. Right? It looks 100% real in their mind. That was the David HaMelech asked Hashem, why you created people that are insane? He said, one day you're going to need it, you understand. That's how he got rid of the prison. Pretended that he's insane. So the king told them, the soldiers, you're crazy? I don't have enough crazy people here. You brought me another crazy one, the Jew. And he got rid of him. That's how he got saved. Second, Shema emin ha'amelim marei ha'nefesh. The bitter ones, the bitter, bitter all the time. Ah, I hate my life. Why are you using drugs? Because I'm miserable. Why are you miserable? He lives in a mansion. He has a nice sport car that his father, daddy, got him. Making scenes with his girlfriend. Doing whatever he want to do. And then what does he do? A miserable emptiness. The neshama suffers. It happens a lot. Not what people from the outside see and jealous. Check again. That's not happiness. So, he's in a deep depression. Deep depression. Thank you. Deep depression. What does it mean, deep depression? Not sadness. Almost every person has moments that he's down. An hour or two later, he's back to reality. That's not what we're talking here about. We're talking such depression that he lay in bed for weeks. Doesn't want to daven, doesn't want to eat, doesn't want to take showers. A month he doesn't take a shower. No haircut. Come, let's have a haircut. Leave me alone. Some teenagers don't leave the house 6 months. 1 minute they don't step outside. They don't want to leave. They sit all day with a computer. It's a sign of depression. Normal person want to go out to do things. They don't want to get out of the house. That's a sign of depression. Sometimes very deep depression. Mechakim lemotam, marei ha'nefesh. Waiting for the day life, their miserable life will be over. He can jump on, he can go up on a terrace, on a roof and jump and commit suicide. Someone like that is not guilty. Dismissed from a punishment. The Chatam Sofer lived in Hungary about 250 years ago. The big rabbi of Hungary. He wrote an answer about someone who committed suicide when it's become mentally ill. It's illness, right? Then you bury him just like a regular Jew. Not outside of the fence, like I said before. The Rambam described right now two different kinds of mental disease. First one, he mixes imagination and reality, is insane. Second one is so deep in depression and bitter that he lost desire to live and to do anything, even simple things. The third will come and make up a story that he actually did it, that they should kill him. Now we're not talking about someone depressed. You understand the difference between this? That's the answer to my question. I ask why the second and the third are not the same thing. Now is the answer. Now we're talking someone bari benafsho, not depressed and not insane. Normal. But he comes to Beit Din and he said that he did that sin, thinking now they're gonna kill me. What kind of a normal person will do such thing? If you tell me be there and depressed, I understand. If you tell me insane, I understand. But normal regular, normal person, why would they come and want to get killed? The answer, יש מצב שבו אדם יהיה משוכנע לגמרי שהוא עשה דבר שבאמת לא עשה. The answer, רבותיי, and for all of the, what I said, is only for this. It's called guilty feelings. רגשות אשמה. He think, I don't deserve to live. I'm a big רשע. I cannot kill myself, and Hashem for some reason doesn't kill me. Let me rush what I deserve. Technically, it's a combination of honesty, high sensitivity and judgment, and false feelings of guilt. I'm guilty. I'm guilty. It's my fault. It's my fault my kids became like that. I should have put him in a different yeshiva. I should have maybe do this with him. I should have not do that. He's looking for a reason why it's his fault. And because he come to a situation, I'm guilty, I don't deserve to live. So he found a way. If I ask my friend to kill me, he won't kill me. I'm not allowed to kill myself. Who's gonna kill me? Sanhedrin. Rabbis, I'm the murderer. I made Chilul Shabbat. I'm telling you, I'm not lying to you. I did this, I did that. Look, I cut the tree. I picked the oranges from the tree. I just had a haircut. He comes right away. Convinced himself. That's called Rikshot Hashma. He believes that he did bad, although he did not. Here you go, I just gave you three reasons why you don't kill a person based on his own testimony. You can kill an innocent person. Did you ever think about this on your own? Would you ever think about something like this on your own? You're in good company. You know why? The judges in the Supreme Court in Israel also never thought something like this is possible until this rabbi taught them that in a court. And the Israeli secular judges, very highly educated people, for the first time they came to this idea that they're actually convicting people that may be innocent. And because of that, they changed the constitution in Israel. That from now on, every person who come and confess about a crime, the police must go from A to Z and tell him, show us, demonstrate what you did from the beginning to the end. How did you shoot her? Where you stood? How did you aim? And then they check the facts scientifically and they say, this guy is normal, not normal. He was from the other side, Bichlal. He could never have been here. And you know how many times they find out that the person never committed a crime? One common thing today in the world is that you have mafia. Rich people, hundreds of millions, billions they have soldiers. They go and kill someone. Sometimes it's the boss himself killed. And now the police have enough evidence to catch him and put him in prison for the rest of his life, or death penalty. He come to one of his poor soldiers in a gang. I'll give you $3 million if you take the guilt on yourself. I'll buy your house, I'll take care of your family, your children, they'll all be rich. $5 million I give you, $10 million I give you. Sit for me in jail. And don't worry, I have connection in jail, I'll make you a king over there. In Israel, in Mexico. That's what's happening. Just come and say you're the one who shot. Here is upfront $2 million. After you do it, I'll wire you another $2 million. I'm a man of my word. And he does. Fantastic. How much I make? $500 a month in Mexico? I get $10 million from the cartel. The big boss. Every time they want to convict him, someone show up. I was the one who shot. What are you going to do now? In Israel, they found a trick. Oh, you're the one who shot? Okay, let's find out how you shot. How did he hold the gun? how many bullets there was in a gun. There's a lot of things. You can catch them right away. What hour it was. What time it was the crime. Not always it's on the news. Yesterday night, last night, person was found dead in his name. But they don't. You don't know. He doesn't know. Oh, you heard? He comes, he takes the guilt. Tell me what time it was. Midnight. Midnight. It was 6 p.m., my midnight. The body is already 5 blocks away. Midnight. Midnight is only 2 hours ago. How the body smells so much. They know right away, he's a liar. Why would a person do it? There's another reason. Rikshot Ashmai Tchuna Shekol Echad Nolad Ito. Guilty feelings is something we are born with. It's in a system. Hashem made us like that. But it has to be balanced. Just like the chemical in the brain and everything else in the body. It has to be a balance. Sometimes the balance is ruined. Ruined. Why? Because of the environment. Because of false feelings that we get. They either make them stronger or weaker. This is a feeling inside the nefesh of the person, very deep, that he has the need to purify, to get purified. I have to purify myself. I want to get purified. One person called me one time, said, Rabbi, you remember that kid, the drug addict? Guess what? He called me up now. He told me if I can take him to the mikveh Friday for Shabbat. I asked him, why a guy like you that is not religious, drug addict, wants to go to the mikveh? He said, I feel the need to get purified for what I'm doing. So the guy was very excited. I told him, you fool. You want to rob the people in the mikveh. Half an hour later, he called me up. You're a genius. How did you know? Drug addict thinks about mikveh. Hashem Yatzilenu. So he wants to punish himself. He has guilty feelings. Even for something he did not do. Sha'alu l'chokhma. This is a midrash. Listen to this midrash. Sha'alu l'chokhma. They asked the wisdom. Chote ma'u onsho. A sinner, what's his punishment? Amra, the wisdom answer. Chataim tirdof ra'ah. Sins brings bad tragedies to the person. No. They ask the prophecy. Sha'alu l'hanevua. Chote ma'u onsho. A sinner, what's his punishment? The prophecy answer. Hanefesh ha'chotet itamut. The sinner has to die. He's responsible for his own sins. Nobody else will pay for his sins. We don't have that stupid concept that JC will die for him. JC won't die for you, John. And not for you, Chris. You're going to pay for your own sins. Sha'alu l'Hashem, they ask Hashem, what's going to be with the sinner? Hashem answer, Yaseh tshuva ve'imachel lo. He will do tshuva, repentance, and I will forgive him. So there are three levels how to react to the sins. One, you got to get punished. Second, you have to die. Third, why? Don't die, don't get punished. Make tshuva, you don't get anything. But real tshuva, not fake. One second. By us, there are Jews who feel the need to torture their body. Fasting, wearing a sack, itching on the body all day, rolling in the ice, in the snow, without a shirt, in 20 degrees. What are you doing? Why are you doing this? We have to pay for our sins. No, better to pay in this olam than olam haba. So it's rolling on the ice without a share. Think about the suffering. Just think, just close your eyes 1 second now. Think that you take your shirt off. There's a pile of snow right here on the street. You come, you lay on the snow, we're on your back in 20 below zero and windy. What a pleasant pleasure. Mamma mia. Delicious, no? How many people will do that? There are people like this in Judaism. Where did they get these ideas from? I won't even answer that. How does the Rambam, the genius, great, legendary Rambam, call these people? Don't say I call them fools. The Rambam called them ksilim. Fools? It's a joke compared to ksil. Fool? It's not so big deal. What a fool. Ksil? I don't even know the right word in English for that. What is a thousand times worse than a fool?
Clown.
A moron? Yeah? It's not a legitimate word, moron, no?
Yeah, moron is legitimate.
Legitimate?
It's not, it's
moron means brainless?
It's a mentality
yeah?
A degree.
So how do you call someone that is a super fool?
Maybe an idiot.
An idiot?
I don't know.
Okay. You see, some words, nobody knows which one is worse than the other. Ask every American, what's worse, fool or an idiot? They won't know. One thing I tell you, I think retard is the right word. Right. Anyway, you got the point? That's what Rambam say. Rambam, Rambam! Not somebody from across the street that learned a few years Gemara and already is a man de Amar. No! Rambam called them ksilim. I read you his words. Because then they say, Rabbi, why don't you read your source? They think I sit home and think, what will I invent today in my lecture? Inventions. Scientists inventing things. וכאשר ראו הכסילים שהחסידים עשו אלה הפעולות ולא ידעו כוונתם. Those fools, so big, giant rabbis, like the Ari HaKadosh, people like that, that they did some of these things. And he's 2 years Baal Tshuva, just grew up his perot, grew up his beard a few months ago. He bought a hat finally. Now he wants to be the Ari HaKadosh. Lo yadu kavanatam, they didn't know the depth behind their actions. To this giant, big, holy people. חשבו שהם טובות. They thought it's good. וכיוונו עליהם. Let's do the same. בחושבם שיהיו כמותם. They thought, I'm going to be the Ari HaKadosh today. Here in Tzfat. I'm gonna roll on the ice. What's the difference between me and the Ari? Here, the same. ויענו את גופם בכל מיני עינויים. They torture their body in all kinds of tortures. ויחשבו שהם קנו לעצמם מעלה. And they live in illusion like they're going high spiritually. I'm in such a level. Psh. Look at me. Psh. I'm somebody special. Why? I'm torturing my body all day. Walking with sack, ashes on my head. At night I roll in the ice. I fast every day. You know, go to the mikveh 5 times a day. All day I'm torturing myself. I break the materialism. Break. I don't sit in a comfortable chair. I know people like this. It's not an imagination. I know. One guy came to the yeshiva 2 months. I said to him, here, here is a good cream cake. Eat. He said, no, I don't eat cream cakes anymore. I asked him why. He said, יותר מדי העולם הזה, כבוד הרב. 2 months he came from the Ma'abara. 2 months ago he was still shooting people. Now he's sitting in yeshiva, he learned half a page Gemara. He doesn't eat cream cakes. חזק וברוך. ממש deserve round of applause. No, do you understand what's going on here? And the Rambam continue, they think, ויחשבו שהם קנו לעצמם מעלה ומידה טובה שעשו טוב. They think, wow, I'm such a special tzaddik. ובזה התקרב האדם להשם. That's what makes me close to Hashem. כאילו השם יתברך hates the body. It's like Hashem hates the body and wants to torture it. That's what he thinks. Where is it? Rambam, 8 prakim, chapter 4. Word by word, I read you his words. Ksilim. Retards. That's what you are, the Rambam said. המחשבה שהאיסורים מביאים לטהרה היא מחשבת הכסילים. The thought that by torturing yourself you become holy and pure, it's a thought of a fool. A smart person doesn't think such a thing. You understand? So if a person wants to be close to Hashem and purified, there are better words than this. Definitely that's not what Hashem wants. You understand? So conclusion of the words of the Rambam. הקדוש ברוך הוא חידש ולימד שתעשה תשובה ובזה תתאר את עצמך. Hashem told us something new, secret, big thing. Make תשובה and you will purify yourself the best way. Don't think תשובה it's easy. I know some of you thinking, I got away easy. I'll do תשובה, big deal. As long as I don't have to roll in the eyes and fast every day, no? It's much harder. No. To do real תשובה, it's not easy. You will see how the Satan will fight you. Every day, non-stop, doesn't give you a rest. Change your actions, change your traits. You consider a Baal Tshuva. What are the influence of guilty feelings on the behaving of a person? When a person has these guilty feelings, which is not real, he never committed those sins. How does it affect him? Let's talk a little bit about kids. Provocation by kids. Provocation, provocative, but many research that were done by Sigmund Freud. You know him? Sigmund, what a name. Sigmund, it's a German name, no? Sigmund. In Germany, Sigmund. Tov. It's like Yosef instead of Yosef. Tov. Sigmund Freud discovered that guilty feelings exist even by babies. Baby, 2 months old. 2 months old! 6 months old! Yes, guilty feelings. Guilty about what? He doesn't understand one word you're talking to him, Bechlal. How can he have in his mind guilty feelings if he cannot even pronounce one word or understand one word? How can it be? The need of the nefesh, the need of the soul to purify, comes to everyone from the minute he is born and come out to the world. Immediately, you come with that to the world. Okay, I understand I came with that to the world, but it will only develop. I have the seed in me. It will have to bloom eventually, no? Ma, right away when I'm 2 months old, it's already active? Isn't it one of those things that you discover at age 7, 10, 13? Right away? Yes, otherwise you wouldn't find it in the research. Let's see how he found it. Kids! There are 3 or 4 who will intentionally make provocation that you will punish them. They're looking for the punishment. They're looking for punishment. Why a kid wants a punishment? You send him to the room or take away something from him. Why? The explanation for that is that it comes from their subconscious because they have guilty feelings. And they are looking for ways to get punished that they can purify themselves to ease their guilty feelings. The kid wants his father to give him a smack. It relaxes his guilty feelings about what he does wrong from a very young age. Kids. Why? It comes from the subconscious. What age the subconscious function normally? From 1 second old. From the second you came to the world. How can it be? You just took your first breath and your subconscious is working? So in case you didn't know, I spoke about it many times. I have a lecture, conscious and subconscious. Listen, watch it. Subconscious, it's a storage that records all your lives when you are in different bodies. Your previous life, the one before, in reincarnations. This baby that is one day old and may look to you like he's not developed and cannot do anything from his in his life, he's not a little kid, he's not a baby, he's an adult. The only difference is that when he's a baby, in his conscious, he's not developed yet. He needs to learn the language of the place, he needs to learn what's table, what's chair, what's everything in the house. It takes years. But the subconscious comes ready to the world. Everything that was recorded from previous life is ready in his subconscious from day one. Anyway, when you are an adult, you're still not aware of what your subconscious has to offer. You don't know. Most people don't know anything about their subconscious. How do I know so much about it? Watch hypnosis, how they hypnotize people. They get all the information out from your previous life, and sometimes people speak in foreign languages and they describe their previous life in different dates, just like it's live. I told that to one Hasid in this Shabbaton, he almost fainted. He told me, are you serious? I said, yes. You go to a parapsychologist, he can hypnotize you and you'll know who you used to be in your previous life. You may even speak Arabic instead of Yiddish. He didn't like that part. That part he didn't like. But everything else, he was shocked. Really? So yes. It's the neshama. What subconscious is? The memory of a person is the soul. Voices that you hear, it's the soul. Everything is engraved in the soul. Every little tiny beep. Now you're sitting here in this beautiful synagogue. Quiet, pastoralic feelings. Your car just passed by. I'm the only one who paid attention to it. Because I wanted. You didn't want to see if a car passed by or not. Here, another one just passed by. For me, it's conscious. For you, it's subconscious. If I would not tell you about these cars now, and I will ask you how long ago a car passed by, you may have no idea. I'm not paying attention. But if I hypnotize you, you will tell me each car that passed by, and you will tell me how it longs and what's the plate number. How? If you sit here inside this beautiful place and you're not sitting outside, you're not outside. How would you know it? The soul records everything, like surveillance camera. Everything is recorded from all directions. Every beep, everything that happened, every smell you ever smelled, it documented at what age, what day, what hour, precisely. Not one thing is disappeared from the soul. Everything is recorded. Unbelievable. Now you understand why the Torah says, "Lo taturu achrei levavchem v'achrei enechem asher atem zonim achareihem." Be very careful not to follow your eyes to see things you're not supposed to see. Not on the street, not in the internet, nowhere. You will never be able to delete it from your soul. Never. Even if you do tshuva, you become a very holy man, and a big rabbi, and Talmid Chacham. If I hypnotize you, everything will come out. Imagine you take one of the biggest Baalei Teshuva of the generations that became very big rabbis. Imagine now they hypnotize them and they bring them when they were 19 years old and they film it on a video. And you see him 60, 70 years old with his beard and his hat, and he's a big Rosh Yeshiva, and such a holy man. And now in the middle of hypnosis, he's going to describe the scenes he used to make with, I don't want to tell you with who. What an embarrassment. Rabbi, still remember it? No. Of course not. He really forgot about it. It was 40 something years ago. He didn't even remember this woman, Bechlal. Mamash, if you talk to him now, he swear on his life. I hold the Torah, I swear to you, I don't know, I don't remember her face, I don't remember her name, nothing. Shem Irachem, I hate to even think about it. Yes, you're right, you're not a liar. But when we hypnotize you, it all comes out. It's in the system. Everything. Once it goes in, it never goes out. Never goes out. No matter how much tshuva you do. It's amazing how Hashem made the neshama of a person with no limit. You don't need X amount of gigabyte, terabyte, all these words. Unlimited. The server of the neshama is greater than all YouTube combined. Imagine how many millions of YouTube's video goes every day on their server. Every day, no, millions. Every day, millions of videos. Every video, 200 megabytes, 700 megabytes, 1 gigabyte. There's a lot of long videos. Constantly going. It's like unlimited ocean. It's not even a drop compared to your soul. You're worth more than all Google. How much Google worth? $100 billion. How much they worth? Here you go. Just for that, you're worth more than them. And now, what about Facebook? Another $100 billion. No, you're already greater than the whole Facebook. So you're already you're right there. You have more storage than both of them combined. At Twitter and all the rest of them, you still have more memory and more space on your storage called subconscious, called the soul. And nobody appreciates its value. Imagine how much you would be worth. So the kids, they make provocations. Why? Because they want to purify and ease their guilty feelings. You understand? We don't pay attention to the unknown and to the subconscious things that works in our life and push us to do things. We don't pay attention where it comes from. We only see from an external view what we are doing right now. We don't know the roots of it. My little children, the subconscious is very clear. It's very strong because it came ready, but their conscious is not ready. That's why the subconscious is easier to detect. And it's easily, can be easily identify the drives to their actions. For instance, you had a new baby. A new baby was born. And your firstborn is 2 years old, 3 years old. And now you just had a new baby. What's the first baby will begin to do once he has a new baby born? He has a brother now. He will start having symptoms, strange behaving. And believe me, he doesn't know what he's doing. It comes from his subconscious to attract attention. How will it attract attention? In two different ways. One from the conscious and one from the subconscious. From the conscious, he's going to draw something and come to his mother. See what the picture I made? That's conscious. He want to take attention. I took the toys like you told me. You want to get an acknowledgement. I'm not going to touch the ice cream. I know you don't like me too. That's all conscious. But there are other things that come from the subconscious, like he begin to move his nose like this when he talks. What happened, Ari? Why you go like this? Don't go like this. 2 seconds later, again. When he grow up, you show him the video when he was 4. Look, when your baby brother was born, look how you spoke and how you made faces. And he will think and say, I can't believe I did it. Why would I do such stupid things? It wasn't him, it came from the subconscious. The suffering expressed in such a way. So the body is reacting to the suffering. It's unbelievable. The body is much more sophisticated and the nefesh than what we even imagine. Sometimes by kids, only when you give them a smack, they will calm down. 500 times you ask them to stop, and they don't stop. Why? They're waiting anxiously for the smack. Anxiously. Not like today they say. Don't ever smack your kid. Of course, you're not allowed to hit them and to hurt them. It's just a smack. Just to a little bit on the hand. It's enough. They got the point. Why is it? It doesn't have to be physical pain. No, that's not the point. When smacking, that doesn't mean to hurt him. It's not revenge. It's just for him to be insulted. My father just gave me a smack, or even a little bit in the behind. Not painful. You can even raise your hand and pretend you give him a smack. Just barely touched him. He was looking for it from his subconscious. As soon as he feels that he lost something, his nefesh comes down. I got what I deserve. Now I can continue. I got what I deserve. Very interesting. This is scientific research. Time is running out. We have a few more minutes. I met criminals in jails in Israel that when they went to steal, to rob places, I asked them, what is your drive to go and steal? What's your motivation? They say, we only did it to be caught. We were hoping to get caught, that we should go to jail. Why is it? You see over here that a person has a drive to receive a punishment when he thinks that he's guilty of something. I deserve it. I need to get it. Give it to me. Give it. I deserve it. And the reason for it is that the guilty feelings are bothering the person in his conscience. It's a spiritual pain. Unbearable pain sometimes. Why people have the need to confess about a murder they committed when they got away with that? The police did not catch them. They tried everything. A year went by. Until he will get it out of his system, he won't relax. I'm going to confess. Why? They didn't catch you. Even when the person deserved to die, he came to rob you or to kill you and you killed him first. Someone sent me a video yesterday, shocking. I don't know where it was, because there's no voice, no audio. It's just a security camera. Two people came up to the building, waited by the door. A man and a woman are walking up the stairs to their apartment. The woman is looking in her bag for the key, and the man is standing next to her. Doesn't look like her husband. It looks like he's a bodyguard, or I don't know what the case. And first they show the two people come up. One is hiding on the side of the door, and one is constantly looking down the stairs to see if they're coming. And then apparently he heard that they're coming up the stairs, so he went to the other side, disappeared from the camera. And then when the man and the woman are trying to get into the apartment, the other one came out with a gun. They tried, I guess they tried to get them in and to rob them. I don't know what to do to them. And the other person came, and the person that was with the woman somehow pulled out the gun, turned around and shot him. And he started to go down the stairs and he's shooting him, one, two, three, and kill him, mamash, like this. The camera showed the whole thing. Like today, the ambassador of Russia, in the middle of a speech, somebody, a Turkish policeman, came and shot him for Syria. Someone in Israel made a comment, how a civilized, handsome man like this is also a Muslim murderer. Meaning is not primitive with a turban or kafia. Or he's not Al-Qaeda or ISIS or Taliban. He has a suit. Meaning is civilized. Take your dog, get him an Armani suit and put him a tie. And put a cat over there. The suit will make him disciplined. Ma, Ishmael, pere adam yado bakol veyat kolbo, whether he wears suit, whether he wears jalabiya. You think it makes a difference? People don't understand how Hashem made the world. When something is written in the Torah, that's it. It's a fact. It's a fact. Oxygen, without it, you're dead. It's a fact. Ishmael, without causing problems to the world and bloodsheds, they cannot survive. That's how Hashem programmed them. There's nothing you can do. And they'll do it until Mashiach comes, and then they pay the price for their actions. No agreement will ever help with Muslims. Never. According to the Muslims, if they occupy the city even for one day, in Spain, Portugal, Denmark, anywhere, and they were kicked out in a battle, but they had possession of the city, they can never rest until they release the land from the original owner claiming it's theirs. Hamas. No wonder they call them Hamas. You know what Hamas means in Hebrew? Stealers, thieves. Everything they see, they say it's ours. Even though they know they've never been in Israel. The new ambassador that Donald Trump nominated, Friedman, supposedly is wearing a yarmulke and is a very right-wing leader, already announced the embassy will be moved to Jerusalem, like the plan, because the Jews are the only nation in the world that always lived in Jerusalem. They didn't need to occupy it from anyone. It was always theirs when there was no such thing Palestinian in existence. Did you ever hear an American politician speak like that? Things are changing. Politically correct system is dying out. The provocative speakers winning. They have the highest success now.
It's turning because the UN, they denied the Kotel on a connection with the Kesher with Jerusalem.
The UN is the Babylonian Tower. What do you expect? Migdal Babel. Don't worry, the UN will go on fire very soon. That's what's going to happen. What do you think? Hashem is going to let them go get away with all their decisions against the Jews? Everyone, the Arab has a say. Every kalb bijiyomo. You know what? Every dog, his day will come. The Arabs hate dogs very much. If a dog touch an Arab, he goes crazy. They don't like dogs and chazir and pigs. Where the Arabs learn that dog and pig is bad? From the Torah. Like everything else they learn when it's good. Then they added their nonsense to the Torah and messed it all up. Unfortunately. Before they got involved with the Quran, they would follow the Torah. It would be wonderful for them. Maybe some discipline. Once they got this Quran, the problems began. So, listen to this, what he's saying now. This is a person who walked years in jails with the biggest criminals in the history of Israel. The murderers, the head of the mafias. They could never leave jail without a letter from him to the judge. That's how powerful he was. Everyone that is ready to go out on good behavior needs his evaluation and recommendation. So he says, I asked the thief, what drives you to constantly go and steal? We want to get caught. Why? The guilty feeling bothering them. Only when he gets punished, it is the guilty feeling, psychologically. Few times I suggested to the criminals that I can prevent their punishment by speaking to the judge. And they refused. Don't do it. Just leave it in the hand of the judge. I can go and I can talk to the judge. I'll cancel it. No. Let the judge give me what I deserve. Please don't get your nose involved here. How can it be? Usually a person does not want to go to jail. Please help me out. But if you have guilty feelings, of course I deserve it. Let me go there. That's where I belong. Don't protect me again. Guilty feelings. There was one professor, high, big shot, that was a spy against his own people, against Israel. Spy for the enemies. And he got a very severe jail time. And most of that he was in isolation, in a small room, 2x2. His family did everything they can that he will get forgiveness from the president. President can give him a release.
Pardon,
yeah. You know. So, they got the president to agree to release him. But the law says that the prisoner himself has to write a letter to ask from the president to release him, to forgive him. No one can do it for him. He has to do it. Only then the president can sign on an order to release him and give him pardon. I met with him a few times, this famous spy. Inside stories here. And he refused to ask for forgiveness from the president. He told me, "Hizakti lamdina, I damaged the country. Why should I get out before I finish my full punishment? I'm paying for what I've done." I told him, the law said that the president can give you a dismissal. And if the president agree, that's the law. That's a part of the law. You're not going against the laws. And it's enough that you set some of the years and not all of it. And he refused and he insisted that he deserved the full sentence. Can you believe it? They're telling him, "We get you out of jail, you'll be free again to make millions." No, keep me here until the end of the sentence. From here you see that he needs to be clean from his guilty feelings, because there's no other way to explain it. One of the hardest things dealing with the criminals is the difficulty of releasing them from their guilty feelings. It's a very difficult mission. No matter how much you talk to them psychologically, it doesn't go away. Does not go away. Sometimes after the criminal already had normal life, normal, I had to work with him one more extra full year to release him from his guilty feelings. This was the hardest thing in working out, bringing him back to normal. So we conclude, and that's where we finish today. We conclude, guilt is feelings that a person feels after he committed a sin. Guilty feelings, it's imaginable feelings for something you didn't really commit. It's an internal drive to purify yourself for things that you imagined that you did, but you never did. You're imagining you committed sins and you want not to get the punishment to clean you from what you deserve to get. And it's all an illusion. You're not really guilty. You did what the Torah said. Mixed of guilty feelings and guilt. Sometimes you really did something, but you also have false feelings. And they get mixed together. Meaning you deserve $1,000 fine for what you did. No big deal. But you increased it so much in your imagination, I deserve execution for what I've done. What? What did you do? In his mind, that's the only way. Irbuv shel ashma v'rikshot ashma. This is a situation that a person actually committed a sin, but he increased the guilt by a lot. That starts with a real failure and expanded into an imaginable guilt that you don't really deserve. The root of helping those three conditions that I just mentioned is to understand that the nefesh, the soul, has the need to purify and naturally feels that by being punished, it will be purified. We, the adults, the educator, have an obligation to teach the student that Hashem is not interested in this kind of purified. No. Like it says in the prophet Yechezkel 18, "Ki lo achpotz bemot harasha," I'm not interested that the wicked people should be put to death. No. "Ki im beshuvo midrachav v'chai," that he will make tshuva, that he should live. I'm not interested that he will die, executed, choking, stoning. No. Punishments are punishments. But I rather that he won't be punished. I rather he will do tshuva, that I don't have to kill him. So I'm not interested to kill you. Why you want to die? That's not what I want. Hashem wants us to be attached to him. That's the purification. That's how we purify ourselves. And this is only coming by good deeds that we're going to do. Tshuva, Torah, and mitzvot. Ma'asim tovim, good deeds. Learning Torah, working on our bad traits. This is the right, correct, pure way to purify our soul. That's the right way. No other ways that I mentioned tonight. No other ways. The last story for today, which will take another minute and we're done, relates to this. I was very surprised to see the need of people to purify themselves even though they had no knowledge about Judaism whatsoever. Now, once in their life they heard Shiur Torah or Musar or anything. Never. As I work as a probation officer, I used to meet big criminals, many of them. Some of them committed serious crimes and were deep in sins, deep. While talking to them, I always discovered they have the inside need to purify. Every time I was surprised again and again and again. There was one guy sitting in jail. The judge did not agree to release him unless Hoffman will release him in a letter, will recommend. After meeting with him, every time he saw a judge, the judge extended his jail time. He asked to meet with me. He was a very, very high-class criminal, probably a murderer. Every time after he was released, he used to go back again to all his crimes and stealing and robbing and all these things. It looked like he doesn't care about anything and nothing scares him. There's no way to threaten him, nothing. He just does whatever he wants. I told him, I cannot recommend to the judge to release you as long as you stay criminal. Every time you were released, you went right back to your crimes. If you promise me you stop, I take your word for it. I will recommend to the judge. He said, I'm not ready to promise. It took a long time until he promised to stop being a criminal. That meeting, when he promised me to stop, he asked me for a pen and a paper. Pen and a paper. I asked him, what do you need a pen and a paper? He said, I want to write a letter to my parents in Morocco. A Moroccan Jew. I said, why is it so urgent to you now in the middle of the meeting with me to write a letter to your parents in Morocco? So the criminal answer, it's been few years that my parents sending me letters from Morocco. I came here as a kid, as a teenager, that they took from Morocco and brought kids alone to Israel and put them in an indoor, you know, school with dorms. As long as I was a criminal and doing what I did, I felt dirty. I could never write a letter to my traditional religious parents in Morocco. They're such good people and so different than me. But the moment now that I gave you my word that I'm done with the crime, I have such a relief now that I feel the urge right away. I cannot wait another second to write a letter to my parents to reply for all the letters they've been sending me. What do you see over here? 100% the need of the person. I have to be worthy. I'm not worthy for this. Sometimes you offer a person a job, I'm not the guy for the job. No, I think you're good. Believe me, Rabbi, you don't know me. I'm a big Rasha. Chas v'shalom, why you say like this? Trust me, I'm a Rasha. You don't know me. Believe me, if you knew me, you wouldn't give me this job. He needs the urge to purify himself. Sometimes it's for real. Most of the time it's for imagining. For illusions. or sometimes listening to the bad things or to people that exaggerated and got him paranoid, and he didn't think that by tshuva you can erase those sins easily in a day or two or a week. You don't need to suffer for years with guilty feelings. It makes you depressed and sad, and take away your desire to keep mitzvot and to pray in the morning and to put tefillin and to go to shul. You come to a point that you see religious people, you don't want to even talk to them. What am I doing among these tzaddikim? I don't belong here. It's all imaginary system. This is the way of the Satan to destroy a person from inside. Like cancer taking the body over, this is taking the soul over. What's the solution? You're never going to feel me. No more guilty feeling, Habibi. No more. I made a sin. Yes, I'm sorry, Hashem. You know I'm sorry. I'm not going to sit and be depressed over it. What? I read Tehillim. I learn a lot of Torah. I work on my midot. I ask in a tefillah for mechila, and I move on with my life. How do I fix my sin? Run to the Gemara, run to the Halakha, run to the Rambam, run to the Sifrei Musar. That's how I make. Take another CD, put it in there, drive all day listening, all day to lectures, make me strong. I look at the Satan in the eyes and make fun at him. Like Flamo used to do. Flamo used to curse the Satan every day. The arrow should come in between your eyes. Satan went crazy that such a big tzaddik is cursing him every day. One time the Satan decided to take revenge against him. He came to him like a poor person, pretending he's a poor person. I'm starving, give me food. Wait here, I'm going to get you food from the kitchen. By the time he went and got him something to eat, he pretended he died in his living room. And now the Satan made noise outside. Flamo killed the visitor. Flamo killed the visitor. It was Erev Yom Kippur. 2 hours before the fast, he got so nervous, he ran away out of town to the bathroom. The bathroom wasn't like now, $100,000 Italian marble with few buttons inside your home. It was far away. There's no flushing system. Nobody wanted the smell, so they put it far away. They keep covering it with sand, you know? So he had to go all the way. He was hiding inside the bathroom in Erev Yom Kippur. Kol Nidrei, supposed to start, is hiding in a bathroom. Yom Kippur, from fear. They say, I killed a poor person. Then the Satan showed up in the bathroom. Moments before Yom Kippur started, he said, I'm the Satan, I fooled you. You didn't kill anyone. Why did you do this to me? Why? You started. You're every day cursing me. So Flamo said, what? You're making us make sins against Hashem. What do you want me to bless you? He said, well, why did you have to wish me that the arrow come in between my eyes? What do you think I'm doing? I'm choosing what to do. I do what Hashem told me to do. Meaning, I'm a tzaddik. I do exactly what Hashem said. It's not that I enjoy my job. By the way, he does enjoy his job, but that's besides the point. So they somehow made peace. And Flamo was able to go and daven in shul, Baruch Hashem. We'll see you with Zrat Hashem next Monday. Remember, next Monday is the final shiur here, and then we'll take a break of a month, and we'll be back after. Baruch Adonai l'olam. Amen v'amen.
No, I did before.